Our topic for session 12 is sanctification. Sanctification literally means a cleansing. It refers to getting rid of filth. It involves the process of getting rid of sin. Let's talk about why we need to go through the process of sanctification after we are born again. Let's begin at 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23. And may the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray that your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. I explained in session 11 that according to the Bible, we are a spirit, and we have a soul, and we live in a body. So we are a triune being. Now Isaiah 59 verse 2 says that sin separates us from God. The meaning of holiness, or to be holy, according to the original Hebrew, means to separate yourself from the world for God. When you get sin out of your life through the process of sanctification, you become more holy, and holiness produces more wholeness. Wholeness is good health in spirit, soul, and body. After salvation, we need to go through the process of sanctification. Our spirit, soul, and body needs to be sanctified. Yes, even your spirit needs to be sanctified, and I can show it to you in the Word. Paul taught sanctification of the spirit, soul, and body in 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1. He said, "Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God." Why would you want to just have healing of your soul and body and not sanctification of your spirit as well? Why would you want to eliminate the total manifestation of healing of physiological disease? The whole project is spirit, soul, and body. This is true wholeness. In session 11, I showed you how to discern the source of your thoughts. Who tempts you with thoughts of worry about the future? Who taught you to have fear and anxiety? The spirit of fear. If you have high blood pressure, you have become one with the spirit of fear in spirit, soul, and body. If you have the spirit of fear, that is not a clean spirit. That is an unclean spirit by its fallen nature. So you need to cleanse yourself from all filthiness of the spirit. In other words, you need to repent for becoming one with the spirit of fear through worrying about the future. And you need to get the spirit of fear out of your life by commanding it to leave in the name of Jesus. That is sanctification of the spirit. In the last session, I spoke about the misunderstanding of possession, and I'll mention it again. There is a big debate over whether or not a Christian can have an evil spirit or not. But it is not about possession. It's about servitude to sin. The evil spirit could be inside, outside, or on Pluto with a megaphone. The point is, you've been listening. Being born again doesn't make you immune to evil spirits. Walking in love and obedience does. After sanctification of the spirit, your soul needs to be sanctified. Remember, your soul consists of your mind, will, and emotions. Why does your soul need to be sanctified after salvation? Well, did you notice that after you are born again and you had said the sinner's prayer, you still had the same bad habits and sinful mindsets that you had before you were born again. You still have sin in your life, even though you are born again. When you are saved by Jesus from your sin, your emotions and mindsets are not saved. You still have to go through the process of sanctification of your soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions. Well, how do you sanctify your soul? With the Word. In John 17, verse 17, we see, it says, "Sanctify them, purify, consecrate, separate them for yourself, make them holy by the truth. Your Word is truth." In Ephesians 5, verse 26, Jesus is talking about the bride of Christ in the church, and he says, "So that he may sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the Word." Sanctification of the soul through the washing of the water of the Word is basically renewing of your mind. In session 9, we spoke about Romans 12, verse 2, which says, "Do not be conformed to this world, fashioned after and adapted to its external superficial customs, but be transformed and changed by the entire renewal of your mind, by its new ideals and its new attitude, so that you may prove for yourself what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God, even the thing which is good and acceptable and perfect in His sight for you." Remember, the condition for healing is repentance. Repentance means changing your thinking, which is renewing your mind. When you renew your mind, your body will conform to health, because whatever goes on in your thought life, your brain converts into a physical reaction. When you are living in divine health, you have proved for yourself God's perfect will for your life. Remember, in session 9, I explained that God's perfect will is actually not healing. His perfect will is that you don't get sick in the first place. Living in divine health is a biblical principle, and it should be our way of life. In Ephesians 4, verse 23, we read, "And be constantly renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh mental and spiritual attitude, and put on the new nature created in God's image, in true righteousness and holiness." Remember, renewing your mind basically means changing your thinking to the way that God thinks. And the only way to find out how God thinks is to study His Word, in other words, the Bible. In our example in the last session of high blood pressure, you are sick because of a thought life dominated by fear, anxiety, and stress, and you need to renew your mind in this area. You need to get a fresh mental and spiritual attitude. You need to put on your new nature as a child of God. You need to break those toxic thinking habits by purposefully meditating on thoughts from the Word of God. For example, "God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a calm and well-balanced mind." That's 2 Timothy 1 verse 7. "Father, I cast the whole of my cares, all my anxieties, all my worries, all of my concerns, once and for all on you, for you care about me affectionately and you care about me watchfully." That's 1 Peter 5 verse 7. "Therefore God's peace, which surpasses all understanding, is guarding my heart and mind." That's Philippians 4 verse 6. "Because I have your peace, Lord, I will not let my heart be troubled. I will not allow myself to be agitated and disturbed. I will not permit myself to be fearful, intimidated, cowardly, and unsettled." That's John 14, verse 27. "The fear of man brings a snare, but because I lean on, trust in, and put my confidence in the Lord, I am safe and set on high." That's Proverbs 29, verse 25. "I have no need to give any thought for tomorrow or worry about the future, because God is my provider." "Father, I thank you for your promise in Hebrews 13, verse 5, where God himself has said, 'I will not in any way fail you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support.' I will not, I will not, I will not." And it really says, "I will not," 3 times in the Amplified Bible. "I will not, I will not, I will not in any degree leave you helpless, nor forsake you, nor let you down, or relax my hold on you. Assuredly not." So I can take comfort and be encouraged and confidently and boldly say, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be seized with alarm. I will not fear or dread or be terrified. What can man do to me?" That's Hebrews 13 verse 6. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear or dread? The Lord is the refuge and stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" That's Psalm 27 verse 1. "I fear not. There is nothing to fear, for God is with me. I will not look around in terror and be dismayed, for the Lord is my God. He will strengthen and harden me to difficulties. Yes, God will help me. Yes, He will hold me up and retain me with His victorious right hand of rightness and justice." That's Isaiah 41 verse 10. Lastly, Joshua 1 verse 9. "Father, you commanded me in your word to be strong, vigorous, and very courageous. So I will not be afraid or dismayed, for the Lord my God is with me wherever I go." So as you begin to think like this, you are breaking your mental habit of fear, anxiety, and stress. And you are retraining yourself in your thought life. You are training yourself to trust God and His Word and not to worry about the future. You are renewing your mind, which means changing your thinking to the way that God thinks. Once again, the only way that you can find out how God thinks is by studying His Word. In previous sessions, I emphasized the importance of obedience and being a doer of the Word. You need to know how God thinks, because if you don't know how He thinks, then how can you be a doer of what He thinks? A big problem in the church today is that Christians simply do not know the Word. As a result, they are easily swayed by false teachings and doctrines that come along. Your ignorance is the devil's playground. You are perishing from all sorts of diseases because of your lack of knowledge. You have got to know the Word. Take responsibility, sit down, and study it for yourself. In Mark 4 verse 24 we read, "Be careful what you are hearing. The measure of thought and study you give to the truth you hear will be the measure of virtue and knowledge that comes back to you, and more besides will be given to you who hear." The word translated as virtue in the scripture is the Greek word dunamis, which means power or ability. So Mark 4 verse 24 is saying that the measure of thought and study that you put into the word will be the measure of power, ability, and knowledge that will come back to you. Basically, you will get out of the Word of God what you put into it. The more time you spend studying the Word and purposefully thinking about it, the more revelation you will get about what it means and its relevance to your life. The more you study the Word and the more you meditate on it, the more power and ability you will have to obey and do it. Many people simply do not put much effort of their own into studying the Bible. They listen to the sermons preached on church or on TV occasionally, but they don't take the time and effort to make the Word a major part of their lives, which includes thinking about it. Our carnal nature is basically lazy, and many people don't want to put in the effort to dig deep into the Word for themselves. Then they wonder why they are defeated Christians who are not experiencing the fullness of all that God has promised in their life, including divine health. We are not living in victory as God intended because we don't spend time with God on a daily basis and because we don't know the Word. The measure of thought and study that you put into the Word is the measure of power, ability, and revelational knowledge that will come back to you. How much time do you spend thinking about and meditating on the Word? If you are having problems in your health or any other area of your life for that matter, an honest answer to this question may reveal the reason why. I'm talking about sanctification. Our spirit needs to be sanctified, and then our soul needs to be sanctified through the washing of the water of the Word. Coming back to Hebrews 4, verse 12 to 13, "For the Word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not made manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. In our example of high blood pressure, which I explained is caused by worry about the future, you get into the Word and it tells you in 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 that God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Psalm 34 verse 4 tells you that the Lord will deliver you of all of your fears. So now the Word of God has come like a two-edged sword to separate the spirit from the soul, and it shows you that what has been speaking to you is the spirit of fear. The Word of God has just exposed to you the creature of Hebrews 4 verse 13 that exists that you cannot see with your physical eyes, but that the Lord can see in the spiritual realm, which is the invisible kingdom described in Ephesians chapter 6. Therefore, through the Word, which is a two-edged sword, you are able to get separated in soul and spirit from fear, whereas before you were one with the spirit of fear in the way of thought. You get rid of that spirit of fear and you become one with the law of God by the renewing of your mind through meditation on the Word. So now you're having your mind retrained to think how God thinks, which is not to worry about tomorrow. As your soul becomes one with the law of God, it begins to prosper. And in 3 John verse 2, it says that you will prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. So as your soul begins to prosper, your body begins to prosper, because the quality of your health is determined by the quality of your thinking. So as you go through the process of renewing your mind, where you change your thinking by meditating on the Word of God, you are building healthy, lush trees in your brain. These lush trees secrete chemicals that remove the thorns from the thorn trees that were built from all those years of toxic thinking. As those thorn trees are gradually replaced by lush, healthy trees of memories in your brain, your mind is also literally renewed on a physical level. And through the mind-body connection, you begin healing. In our example of high blood pressure, the hypothalamus will restore the balance between the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, so the blood vessels return to their correct diameter and you no longer have high blood pressure. Thousands of people globally no longer have high blood pressure because of this teaching. Now I'd like to summarize everything that I've been sharing with you up until this point in this DVD series, to help you to bring everything into one big picture. How does disease develop? In our example of high blood pressure, the spirit of fear speaks to you via theta brainwave activity with feelings and thoughts in the first person, and it tempts you to worry about the future. In your soul, which is your mind, you begin to meditate on those thoughts which you think are your thoughts, and you begin to get worried, anxious, stressed up, and tense. As you continue to meditate on those thoughts in your mind, you are growing a thorn tree of fear in your brain. So that fear, which was initially spiritual, became part of your soul through thinking, and eventually a part of you physically in the form of long-term memory, which is what I was referring to as toxic thorn trees. You have become one with fear, which is sin, in spirit, soul, and body. That thorn tree of fear doesn't just cause high blood pressure, it sets in motion more than 1,400 known harmful physical and chemical reactions in your body, and it activates more than 30 different hormones and neurotransmitters. In session 3, you saw how fear affects and damages almost every organ system in your body and has the potential to open the door to more than 100 incurable diseases. Let's use another example of depression. An accusing spirit begins to speak to you spirit to spirit through theta brainwave activity with thoughts in the first person. The accusing spirit accuses you to yourself with thoughts such as, I am such a bad person. I'm feeling so guilty for what I've done. I am ugly. I am worthless. I'm inadequate. I am a failure. And you begin to think on those thoughts which you think are yours in your mind, which is your soul. as you continue to meditate on those thoughts, you are growing a thorn tree of guilt, condemnation, a low self-esteem, and self-hatred in your brain. So that self-hatred and guilt, which was initially spiritual, became part of your soul through thinking, and eventually a part of you physically, in the form of long-term memory, which is that toxic thorn tree. The hypothalamus responds to those toxic chemicals on that toxic thorn tree of a low self-esteem and guilt by lowering the serotonin levels in your brain. The deficiency of serotonin causes the symptoms of depression. Let's use another example of cancer. The spirit of bitterness begins to speak to you, spirit to spirit, via theta brainwave activity, with thoughts in the first person. I hate my mother. I'll never forget what my father did to me, and I really resent it. I'm going to get even with you and make you pay for what you did to hurt me. So you begin to think on those thoughts of unforgiveness, bitterness, and hatred, which you think are yours in your mind, which is your soul. As you continue to meditate on those thoughts, you are building a toxic thorn tree in your brain of hatred, unforgiveness, and bitterness. So that bitterness, which was initially spiritual, became part of your soul through thinking, and eventually a part of you physically in the form of long-term memory, which is that toxic thorn tree of bitterness. You have become one with bitterness in spirit, soul, and body. In session 7, I explained to you how a toxic thorn tree of bitterness and unforgiveness can cause cancer. So in summary, the pathway of the development of disease is through the spirit-soul-body connection. Healing comes through exactly the same pathway. Healing begins with sanctification of the spirit, then sanctification of the soul, and then sanctification of the body. In our example of high blood pressure, the spirit of fear was given the legal right to put this disease on us because we were in sin and disobedience to the word, which says in Matthew 6 verse 34, to give no thought for tomorrow. So we have to take away that legal right through heartfelt repentance. For example, Father, from my heart, I repent for worrying about the future and not trusting in you and not trusting that you could take care of me. Please forgive me, Father. Then you get delivered from the spirit of fear, where you say, Spirit of fear, I command you to leave in the authority of the name of Jesus. And the spirit of fear has no choice but to leave. That is sanctification of your spirit. In the case of depression, the accusing spirit was given a legal right to put disease on us because we were in sin and disobedience to the word, which says in Matthew 19 verse 19 that we are to love ourselves. So we have to take away that legal right through heartfelt repentance. For example, Father, from my heart, I repent for not loving myself and for believing the devil's lies that I am not special. Please forgive me, Father. So you get delivered from the accusing spirit, where you say, Accusing spirit, I command you to leave in the authority and name of Jesus. The same applies to the spirit of bitterness in the case of cancer. You repent for being in sin and disobedience by not being a doer of the word, which tells us in Mark 11 verse 25 to 26 to practice forgiveness. Then you command the spirit of bitterness to leave in the name of Jesus. That is sanctification of the spirit. Once your spirit has been sanctified, you need to sanctify your soul through the washing of the water of the word. You need to renew your mind and change your thinking to the way that God thinks, which in the examples of high blood pressure, depression, and cancer, is not to worry about the future, to love yourself because of who you are in Christ, and to forgive others as your Father in heaven has forgiven you. As you take responsibility and the time to purposefully meditate on the word, you are building a healthy, lush tree of long-term memory in your brain. That lush tree will secrete chemicals that flow through those thorn trees and remove the thorns that were secreting the toxic chemicals that were making you sick. Those healthy chemicals released from those lush trees will also flow throughout your body and cause healing where the body tissue was damaged by disease. Proverbs 4 verse 20 to 22 says, My son, attend to my words, consent and submit to my sayings. Let them not depart from your sight, but keep them in the center of your heart, for they are life to those who find them, healing and health to all their flesh. When you renew your mind with the word of God, your body will be healthy because your thoughts are healthy. This is because whatever goes on in your thought life, your brain converts into a physical reaction. Your soul has to be sanctified through the washing of the water of the word before your body will be sanctified. Sanctification of the body means getting rid of disease and everything that destroys it. When you change your thinking by renewing your mind with the word of God, your body will conform to health and disease will not come. That is the pathway to health and defeating of disease. That is being an overcomer. That is why I say that healing begins with sanctification of the heart. I've explained previously that in a biblical context, the word heart means soul and spirit. When our spirit and soul is sanctified, and we have changed our thinking through the renewing of our minds, our body is sanctified through healing. In that order, sanctification of the spirit, then the soul, and then the body. Now coming back to the scripture that I started with, 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23, and may the God of peace himself sanctify you through and through, and may your spirit and soul and body be preserved sound and complete and found blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The title of this message was, Why Do We Need Sanctification After Salvation? Paul told us in Philippians 2 verse 12 to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Why would he say that if everything was complete after we were born again at the cross? He said, work out, cultivate, carry out to the goal, and fully complete your own salvation with reverence and awe and trembling. Again, why would Paul tell us to work out our own salvation if it was finished at the cross and our salvation was complete the moment we were born again? The answer is we still have to go through the process of sanctification of our spirit, soul, and body. Working out your own salvation in this scripture means getting into the Word and cooperating with the Holy Spirit as you allow Him to sanctify your spirit, soul, and body. The sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit involves working out of you your fleshly carnal traits and working into you the character and mind of Christ. This can be compared to when a woman has a baby. The birth takes place in moments, but it takes 18 years to raise the child and teach it good habits. Likewise, when we give our lives to the Lord, we are born again in a few moments. But after that, sanctification of our spirit, soul, and body begins, which is the process of progressively getting rid of sin in our thoughts and in our lives. How long that process takes depends on you to a large degree. Sanctification is about change. In this DVD series, I am saying that in order to get healed, you need to get rid of sin, particularly in your thought life. You need to change your thinking. However, you cannot bring about any lasting change in your life in your own strength, which is why this teaching, apart from God, is useless. I repeat, apart from God, this teaching is useless. Jesus said in John 15, verse 15, apart from me, you can do nothing. I've already explained to you that the only place you can be changed is in God's presence. You need to abide in the vine. You need to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. If you want to enjoy good health and a life of radical and outrageous victory and blessing everywhere you go and in everything you do, as described in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1 to 14, you have got to be a doer of the word, which means you have to walk in obedience. A life of obedience flows from a genuine love for God. A genuine love for God only develops when you get to know Him, and you can only get to know Him through time spent with Him in His presence. If you don't spend time with God And if you don't make the effort to renew your mind with the word, the process of sanctification is going to be a very slow process, or it may not even happen at all. So you are a born-again Christian, and you may have been born again for 10 or 20 or 50 years, but because you are seldom in God's presence and seldom in the Word, you are an unchanged, defeated, miserable, sick Christian who is no different to an unbeliever. As a church, we need to wake up out of our passive, mediocre, lukewarm walk with God. We need to make an effort to get to know the Father more. We need to cultivate a hunger for His Word. We need to fall in love with Him. We need to stir up within our hearts a passion for His name. We need to become radical and outrageous in obedience. I don't want to be like Esau, who exchanged his birthright for a plate of stew. I want to lay a hold of the abundant life that includes divine health that Jesus paid such a high price to give me.
You are the God that healeth. You are a God that reigns on high. You are a God of mercy, and your grace, and your grace.
Pastors, it is not just up to us as doctors to help God's people with their diseases. It is primarily up to you. In the Old Testament, when a person was healed of leprosy, they had to go to the priests to determine if they were clean. Who does it say the sick must go to in the New Testament? The elders of the church. We see this in James 5, verse 14 to 16, where it says, "Is anyone among you sick? He should call the church elders, and they should pray over him, anointing him with oil in the Lord's name. And the prayer that is of faith will save him who is sick, and the Lord will restore him. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. So confess to one another, therefore, your faults, your slips, your false steps, your offenses, and your sins, and pray also for one another, that you may be healed and restored to a spiritual tone of mind and heart." Now, as pastors, you obviously don't need to go to medical school, but you do need to get yourself educated about disease so that you can care for his sheep. And hopefully this DVD series and the book I have written will be a useful tool to help you from both a medical and biblical perspective. In the introduction, I said that disease is as rampant in the church as it is in the rest of the world. And unfortunately, God's people are being sent to the world for help when the answers are right here in the Word of God. There is still a place for doctors, and we do have a key role in helping people with diseases. We have the training and skill to save a person's life in an emergency. There are times when we have to use prescription drugs, for example in a life-threatening or potentially dangerous situation, to get a person into a place of safety. This then buys the person more time to deal with the underlying issues that caused the disease in the first place. Also, we have knowledge and understanding of the human body, which enables us to make a diagnosis of a disease. And without knowing what disease a person has, it's going to be very difficult to know what the spiritual root behind it is. But once the pastor knows what the disease is, it is mostly his job to minister to the person and to disciple him about spiritual issues and the sin behind their diseases. The medical community has been expected to do something that we are often not qualified to do, and that is to pastor God's people and deal with spiritual issues. Now, a healthcare professional who is also a believer can minister to people. But worldly doctors, psychologists, and psychiatrists are the result of the frustration of the failure of the church and its leadership to perform its scriptural mandate in pastoral care. And as you can see from Ezekiel chapter 34, God is rather ticked off about that. In verse 1 it says, "And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say even to the spiritual leaders and shepherds of Israel who feed themselves, should not the shepherds feed the sheep?" Moving on to verse 4. "The diseased and the weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the hurt and crippled you have not bandaged, those gone astray you have not brought back, the lost you have not sought to find." God holds the pastors directly responsible for the health and welfare of their flock. Because the church has failed in this area, people are turning to psychologists and psychiatrists who have become the pastors of this world. Like the doctors, they are attempting to manage the diseases of the soul through the use of psychiatric drugs and various forms of therapy. And as we saw from session 10, they are making a real mess. In session 10, I told you that the number 4 killer of mankind today is properly prescribed, administered FDA-approved drugs. And the number 8 killer of mankind is medical mistakes by doctors, nurses, and people in the healthcare industry. A recent statistic is that 2 million people per year are permanently damaged by the side effects of prescription drugs. Oprah Winfrey once took on the pharmaceutical industry in one of her shows because she had the same statistics and research that I have shared with you. Oprah said that the number of people dying from the side effects of FDA-approved drugs is equal to the number of people that would be on a fully loaded jumbo 747 jetliner that crashes and everybody on board dies every single day of the year. If that happened, where a plane like that crashed every single day of the year, killing everybody on board, people would be up in arms. But that is the amount of people dying from the side effects of drugs, and nobody is even raising an eyebrow. You don't need pills to get well. You just need the gospel. I'm only joking with you. But on a more serious note, I said that because of the failure of the church and its leadership to perform its scriptural mandate in pastoral care, people are turning to psychologists and psychiatrists who have become the pastors of the world. And with all due respect to the healthcare professionals, I don't find psychologists and psychiatrists in the Bible. But I do find the fivefold ministry. I find apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers that were supposed to be the government that taught, discipled and equipped believers for service. But most pastors are farming out their people to the world system of professionals because they have not mastered the understanding of health and disease in the Bible and what creation should look like for themselves. We have gone into captivity and are perishing because of our lack of knowledge. God said to the prophet Isaiah, "My people have gone into captivity because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst. Therefore hell has enlarged herself and opened herself without measure." God is not talking about the people out there in the world. He's talking about his people who are called by his name and set aside by his covenant. The Christian church is not having a heaven of a day. It is having a hell of a day, and that should not be. The Lord's prayer was, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So we should be having a heaven of a day. But you can't have a heaven of a day in your ignorance. Because you are ignorant, you have gone into captivity. And as it says in Hosea 4 verse 6, his people are destroyed because of their lack of knowledge. The fact is that less than 5% of people who are prayed for in the church worldwide, regardless of denomination, are being healed. God's children are perishing, and many pastors seem to be doing nothing about it. The problem is that we do not understand disease, even from a biblical perspective. Sanctification for healing is not a dimension that is being taught in the church today. The church is not teaching why healing does not come. When the members of the church congregation come to the elders for prayer to be healed, they do not even consider that there may be a sin issue that needs to be dealt with first. They are anointed with oil, but they totally forget about the second half of the scripture in James 5 verse 14 to 16, which talks about confessing sin and being restored to a spiritual tone of mind and heart. Carl Jung observed in frustration as his German Protestant minister father preached a powerless gospel that offered no solutions for the diseases of the soul and body. This led him on a journey to look for answers elsewhere. He said, "Because of the failure of Christianity in dealing with the problems of the psyche or the soul and the diseases of the body of man, I will create an alternative to Christianity that will offer mankind some solution and hope." As he began his journey, Carl Jung spent some time with Freud, but he later separated from him after they broke over a disagreement over some definitions. In fact, Freud eventually committed suicide, so much for the sanity of that therapy. Carl Jung then began to investigate spiritism and Eastern mysticism, and he ran into invisible evil spirits, and in his early writings, he actually called them evil spirits. He became a channeler for these invisible spirit entities by using automatic handwriting, otherwise known as journaling. The main spiritual entity that he channeled was a spirit guide called Philemon. Quoting directly from his writings, he said, "All that I know about psychotherapy, my spirit guide, Philemon, taught me." So then, by his own admission, Jungian psychotherapy is a doctrine of devils, which is the invisible kingdom of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. And then Carl Jung also channeled two other lesser spirit entities called animus and anima. The principles of anima and animus are basically this. As a female, in order to be a better female in creation, I need to integrate the masculine part of me into my femininity. And in order for you to be complete as a male, you must integrate the feminine part of you into your creation. That's the premise. Well, in Genesis 1 verse 27, the Word of God says that male and female, He created them. No wonder we are having such a problem with gender disorientation, because we have had something added to us which produces an inordinance of identity. The females do not really feel like they are females anymore, and the males are not sure if they are males anymore. So Carl Jung became a channeler for the evil spirit Philemon, as well as anima and animus. And his writings, by channeling these evil spirits, became the foundation of Jungian psychology. Modern-day psychology includes many Jungian principles. Even some Christian counselors use therapeutic models that are based on Jungian psychology. Well, I am not interested in trying to integrate anima and animus into believers, because we don't need devils trying to heal Christians. 1 Timothy 4 verse 1 says, "But the Holy Spirit distinctly and expressly declares that in latter times some will turn away from the faith, giving attention to deluding and seducing spirits and the doctrines that demons teach." Jungian psychology has also removed the triuneness of our creation. The Bible teaches in 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23 that we are a spirit and we have a soul and we live in a body. In modern day psychology, there is no such thing as the spirit of man. There is the idealistic compartment of the soul, which they call the conscious, and the collective unconscious. This is a very clever deception, because if you remove the spirit of man, you are never going to be able to be healed from psychological or biological diseases. All you are going to do is mess around with prescription drugs and never achieve anything more than disease management. In session 11 and part 1 of session 12, I explained how the development of disease first begins in the spirit realm and later manifests in the physical realm in the form of psychological disorders and biological diseases. The medical field is at a major disadvantage when it comes to healing because they only consider the soul and body but do not acknowledge the other third of our being, which is spiritual. Paying attention to the spirit man is essential because it is the missing link. There is no solution for the diseases of mankind in the soul and body unless we get it right at the spirit level first, because that is where the development of disease begins. It was not a biological disease or psychological defect first. It first began in the spirit level, on the spirit level of man, as a mindset that came out of the mind of Satan. It is the invisible kingdom of Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12 that has programmed mankind to think, speak, and act like it. Disease is a manifestation in the physical of a mindset that the person became one within the soul that had its origin in the spirit. Therefore, to unravel disease, you can't just stay out here with prescription drugs and not consider the toxic sinful thinking pattern which through the mind-body connection caused the disease, and without considering that what taught that person that mindset was a spirit. You need to know how to discern the source of thoughts, and this is something that is not understood by many people. Instead of chasing symptoms or trying to manage symptoms, if you will just get to the root of what causes the symptoms and remove that, then you've got a victory coming. If you can understand what causes the symptoms, you can prevent disease. Instead of working backwards from the body back into the soul, let's first begin at the spirit level, where you remove the invisible kingdom of Ephesians 6 verse 12 that answers to Satan through repentance and commanding it to leave in the name of Jesus. Remember, that is sanctification of the spirit. Then we need to help the person renew their mind with the Word of God so that they replace that old toxic thinking habit with a godly mindset, and that is sanctification of the soul. Then the diseases caused by that toxic sinful mindset will be gone too, and that is sanctification of the body. To try to do inner healing, soul care, counseling, or even renewal of the mind without continuing into the third dimension is a waste of time. Carl Jung saw this invisible kingdom in the spirit dimension very accurately, and as I said earlier, he mentioned evil spirits in his early writings. You can see it for yourself if you go and read his original writings in any public research library. However, Jung believed that modern man would not accept the basic concepts of the Bible in view of their scientific way of thinking. So he deliberately took the words evil spirits from his early writings, and he changed the nomenclature to archetypes and dark shadows to accommodate himself to a more scientific approach. In Jungian psychology, the archetypes and dark shadows are part of the collective unconscious. The Bible reveals that what Carl Jung calls archetypes and dark shadows in the collective unconscious is in fact the spirit of man and the spirit world dimension. It is an intelligent, invisible kingdom, which is the principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places and the rulers and darkness of this present world in the spirit world dimension. The fallacy of Jungian psychotherapy is that you are to identify and come into contact with the archetypes and dark shadows, which he originally called evil spirits, that are part of our ancestral history, which bring with them the darkness and the evil that you need to learn about and understand through therapy. This is actually so that you can cohabit with the evil of your ancestral line generationally. And this is basically what classic Jungian psychotherapy is all about, and it is in direct opposition to the truth of the Word of God. The Bible has said from the beginning that you never cohabit with an enemy. You identify your enemy and you remove it from your land. And any enemy that was allowed to stay became the Achilles heel of the Israelites. That is why Paul said in Galatians 5 verse 24 that you are to crucify or put to death the flesh. The flesh is the carnal nature, or the body of sin, which is the invisible kingdom of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, that Carl Jung identified as archetypes and dark shadows of our ancestral darkness. Christianity is cohabiting with the enemy in the name of therapy. It is no wonder that the worldly doctors, psychologists, psychiatrists, and other variations of medicine are failing. I mentioned previously that with all the drugs that there is to treat biological diseases, over 80% of them are incurable. According to the Journal of American Medicine, the medical community has long given up on the possibility of curing incurable diseases. The journals are filled with the phrase, "there is no cure." And so all they are looking for now is a better form of disease management as they continue to try to bypass the penalty of the curse of disobedience without taking responsibility for the sin behind that disease. Furthermore, the World Health Organization has said that there has been zero advancement in mental health care in the past 20 years. The reason is because the doctors are just trying to manage disease on a purely physical level with pharmaceutical drugs and surgical procedures, while the psychologists and psychiatrists are messing around with thought at the soul level, but they don't consider or even know about the origin of thought in the spirit realm of man. You will never crack biological or psychiatric diseases, and you will never be able to help people eradicate and prevent disease without having the triage approach, which is the spirit, soul, and body. This is a radical approach to something that has been ignored, and it has opened up a whole new dimension to helping people get healed, and it has had incredible results globally. You cannot remove the identification and sanctification of the spirit world dimension of your lives and still get what you are looking for. So I am going to stay with the knowledge and insight in the Bible that helps me to understand the enemy clearly concerning how disease begins in the spirit realm, and I'm going to ignore psychology based on Carl Jung's conclusions because there is no such thing as the collective unconscious. Because the identification of the spirit world has been totally masked through the deception of Jung's teaching and others, psychiatrists, psychologists, and doctors in the world who the world has turned to for help are getting nowhere. And it is the same with the church. Jeremiah 6 verse 13 to 14 talks about the leadership of the Old Testament church and how the priest and prophet dealt falsely. And then it says in verse 14, "They have healed also the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly, saying, 'Peace, peace,' when there is no peace." The pastoral field of Christianity, the psychological field of the soul, and the biological field of medicine has not even put a dent in disease. Awesome. Well, I think it's time to put a dent in it. It's time to go from slight healings to more peace and more healing. You may say, well, we are getting some results. Yes, you are, between 5 and 20%. That is an 80 to 95% failure. If it is not working, why continue to do it? Why practice a science that is not working? I'm not just challenging pastors, but doctors and other people in the medical profession just like me. What are we doing and why are we doing it? What are we doing and why are we doing it? In this DVD series, I want to do more than simply give facts. I hope to impart a desire in the hearts of doctors and other healthcare professionals to help people on behalf of God in maybe a different way to what the world has taught you in the management of biological and psychological diseases. Why should we settle for anything less than what is totally available from God in fixing mankind, which is disease eradication and, even better, disease prevention, rather than disease management, which is just another form of bondage? Why don't we let God be God in our lives and practice medicine His way based on biblical principles, because that is the only way we are going to defeat incurable diseases? Without the principles of God, we cannot ever hope to even achieve health. Now, if you were to operate by these principles that I am sharing with you in your practices in the world, you would probably lose your licenses. Furthermore, not everybody wants to be spiritual, and not everybody wants to change. So we are caught in the world and its system, but we are not of the world. Rather than wasting time and energy fighting the world's old system that is clearly not working, let's start a new system. And it's already beginning. For example, in the Baja Peninsula in Mexico, there is a 1,500-acre piece of land with a 1,000-room resort that has been turned into a teaching ministry hospital. There, healthcare professionals are able to practice the triage approach without governmental interference. The people that go there for help come into a setting where they can stay, be taught and discipled in these principles from the Word of God. And they also have the best technology in the world to help with the diagnosis and investigation of diseases. When necessary, the people are temporarily managed with drugs to keep them in a place of safety while they are being discipled so that God can heal them. They are also developing the very same concept in Argentina and Uganda. In Uganda, there is a group of well-financed Christians that are creating a state-of-the-art cardiovascular hospital to deal with all forms of cardiovascular diseases. Part of their program includes these teachings that come from Henry Wright's ministry and his book A More Excellent Way. For example, when a man comes for a triple bypass operation because the arteries in his heart are clogged up with cholesterol, they will temporarily manage the problem on a physical level with drugs and surgery. However, they will also bring the man and his family to a place of teaching about how cardiovascular disease develops through the spirit-mind-body connection and how it had its origin in either fear, self-hatred, or anger, depending on the specific heart disease. This will then enable them to disciple the man so that he can deal with the spiritual issues that initially caused the disease, so that his disease can be eradicated rather than just doing a triple bypass and then in 5 to 10 years his arteries become clogged up again because the original problem wasn't dealt with. This is a unique concept which is a triage approach to disease healing and prevention. This is about educating a planet in godly principles and re-establishing the kingdom of God on the earth, one person at a time. Let's begin to teach a culture or a nation correct spirituality. Let's begin to educate families and principles concerning relationships with God, themselves, and others. Let's teach them how relationship breakdowns produce disease. Rather than constantly putting band-aids on disease through disease management, let's redefine our whole approach to disease. According to 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23, health includes wholeness in spirit, soul, and body. So I want to challenge the psychiatrists and psychologists. Why are you only stopping at the level of the soul or the mind? If you are a believer, why don't you also move into healing of physical diseases? The same applies to doctors. Rather than just messing around with disease management on a physical level, also address sanctification of the soul and spirit. What has to happen is a triage approach where, as believers and healthcare professionals, we move into ministry on all three levels, spirit, soul, and body. Let's redefine health and healing and disease intervention globally, regardless if the country is Christian or not. We can still go into Islamic, communist, and Buddhist countries and begin to educate them in pathways that produce health that are based on biblical principles. Since the rain falls on the just and the unjust, if mankind will begin to live by godly principles, he will enjoy the blessings of godly principles. And many people have been healed by God that were not saved. But when they were healed, they wanted to know how that happened, and there you get a chance to teach them about the great God who loves them. I hope this message has created a rumbling in your hearts. Maybe I can plant a seed of maturity that will bust hell wide open in every category of disease that you can think about. The ministry of Henry Wright and other doctors who are applying these principles are having a success in seeing people healed from biological, psychological, and psychiatric diseases that is unequaled anywhere in the world, because they understand the pathway of development of disease through the spirit-mind-body connection. People are getting healed left, right, and center of major incurable diseases such as stage 4 terminal cancer, and nobody is even praying for them. It is just knowledge, discipleship, conviction, and repentance. Most of the diseases that are considered incurable are actually very easy to get rid of and to prevent. We just need to be properly taught from the Word of God. Pastor Henry Wright heads a ministry that has people coming to him from all over the world for help. He reports that 45% of people seeking help are not saved and do not go to church. So the world is turning back to the church. So this time, let's be ready with the answers. As a doctor, I am making an appeal to all pastors across the world today to get educated about disease and to educate the people in your church about disease, so that you can lead the people of God out of the claws and clutches of hell and what it represents. Up until now, we have been a people of God who were bound by ignorance. And because of our lack of knowledge, we were being killed left, right, and center by disease and didn't know why. Neither did the medical community know why. But God has given us His Word. He has given us the Holy Spirit to confirm the Word. You don't have to be at the mercy of the world's system of professionalism that does not understand the spiritual dimension of creation. The secrets to health and healing are found in the Bible, and not in science. So let's wake up the sleeping giant called Christianity and bring it to its knees in repentance. It's about time that as a church we operated in healing and deliverance as a way of life. We should be setting the standard for mankind on this planet, not the other way around. The Bible says that the manifold wisdom and counsel of God for the ages should be and is to be demonstrated, not just taught, but demonstrated through the church.
You are the God that healeth. You are a God that reigns on high. You are a God of mercy, and your grace, and your grace
. I am well aware that I am just one of an army of people that God is raising up all over the world to take this message to His people. I know that there are going to be pastors, doctors, other healthcare professionals, even housewives and people of all types who will have the Spirit of God stir something up within their hearts to go into ministry and to teach the truth and principles of God concerning healing that I have shared in this DVD series. And this did not start with me. Henry Wright is the pioneer of this teaching, and through him, God has inspired me to do what I am doing. If you are a pastor and you desire to use the book that I have written or this DVD series to teach these principles to your congregation, or if you are a doctor, psychologist, or another healthcare professional who would want to use my material to educate your patients, or if you are a businessman who would want to develop a welfare program for your employees to cut down the costs of absenteeism, and you want to use this teaching as a part of your program, or anybody who would want to use this DVD series or the book or my book I have written to reach out to people who need help, or to teach this material in your families, in Bible studies, in your church, and in your cities, I would be delighted for you to do so. You need not ask my permission. But there is a copyright on this material prohibiting it from being reproduced in whole or in part in any form for financial profit, and legal action will be taken if it comes to my attention that anybody is doing so. Furthermore, make sure that your heart motive is right. There are many people who don't really have a heart of compassion for God's people. They take this material and teach it, not because they care, but because they want the success, and they want to be somebody, and this is their ticket to fame. That is the wrong spirit, and when they stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and their works are tested with fire, it will not stand. Furthermore, before you try and get the world converted, make sure you are converted yourself. You need to become who you are in God first. Yearn for that development. Yearn to grow in Him. Learn to pursue and to seek Him and to press into God for yourself. Stay teachable, be reprovable, and here is a secret about God. Simply be available. If you will just be available, God will soon send people to you who need help. And if you don't feel equipped and you feel inadequate, never mind, we all feel like that. Just step out in faith and allow God to use you. Open your hearts as I speak to you. You never know, it might just be you that God raises up and uses. But if you have an inordinate desire and wrong motive for it, it won't be you. For those people who have been inspired to teach this knowledge and insight, I would like to take a moment to give you a word of warning and also a word of encouragement. I am taking the time to share this with you because I wish somebody had shared this with me when I first started out. Persecution is more than likely headed your way, and I can tell you where it will most likely come from so that you won't be surprised. The people who persecuted Jesus were not the non-Christians. It was the religious leaders of the day, and it will be exactly the same with you. The pastors, priests, and prophets of the Old Testament church didn't like it because Jesus was helping people and they couldn't. So anytime you try to help people, for example, to get healed, and the other camp can't, or they teach against it, you come under incredible persecution. And I've had my share because I'm calling people to repentance, beginning in the church. You will go out there because it is simply your desire to help people for God, and all of a sudden, you come under attack. If you are not prepared, you won't know what has hit you, and there is an overwhelming sense of discouragement and loneliness. But what greatly encouraged me was a word God gave Henry Wright, who has also seen a tremendous amount of persecution. In fact, he has entire evangelical church denominations that have meetings to conspire ways to shut him up and prevent him from teaching this knowledge and insight that I am sharing with you. In a conference, one pastor who had also come under some attacks stood up and he asked Henry Wright how he handles all this persecution that comes his way. This was Henry Wright's answer, and I'd like to encourage you to remember this in your heart. God spoke to me one day when I was reeling under the attacks of my fellow brethren for teaching the truth at this level. And God said, Henry, if you will just stay faithful and keep your heart right, for every one that curses you, I'll raise up 1,000 who bless you. So every time I come under attack by one of these chiefs of the Sanhedrin, I begin to become excited because I know that there is at least 1,000 believers that are about to get healed and delivered somewhere in the world. And that is worth the persecution. Jesus said in John 15, verse 20 to 22, remember what I told you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word and obeyed my teachings, they would also keep and obey yours. But they will do all this to you, inflict all this suffering upon you, because of you bearing my name and on my account, for they do not know or understand the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin and would be blameless. But now they have no excuse for their sin. To be honest with you, if I was not being persecuted in some way, I'd be concerned, because it would mean that I am not being a big enough threat to the devil. When you are making an impact for God's kingdom, the devil is going to come against you. When you are persecuted, it is a good sign that you are on the right track. 1 Peter 4 verse 12 to 14 says, "Beloved, do not be amazed and bewildered at the fiery ordeal which is taking place to test your quality, as though something strange, unusual, and alien to your position were befalling you. But insofar as you are sharing in Christ's sufferings, rejoice, so that when His glory, full radiance and splendor is revealed, you may also rejoice with triumph. If you are censured and suffer abuse because you bear the name of Christ, blessed are you, happy, fortunate to be envied, with life, joy, and satisfaction in God's favor and salvation, regardless of your outward condition. Because the Spirit of glory, the Spirit of God, is resting upon you. On their part He is blessed, but on your part He is glorified." So don't be surprised when persecution comes your way. Rather be encouraged, because it means that the Spirit of glory is resting on you.
And you are the God that healeth. You are a God that reigns on high. You are a God of mercy, and your grace, rains down.
This teaching comes from a sermon preached by Henry Wright. Have you ever seen a fearful and anxious person? How could you tell? You could see it in the expression of their face, in their talk, and in their mannerisms. And what did you say? "He's such a fearful person." No, he's a person who has fear, and that is the way that you need to be taught. You may say, "I'm a fearful and anxious person." No, you're a person who has fear. There's a difference. Have you ever seen people with a low self-esteem who hated themselves? They're depressed and always putting themselves down. Have you ever seen a person like that? How could you tell? They were dressed up in it. And you would say, "He's a depressed person," or, "Well, I'm such a depressed person." No, you are a person that has a spirit of heaviness that makes you depressed and hasn't allowed you to put on the garment of praise. Have you ever seen somebody who had lust? How could you tell? When they looked at you, especially if you are a woman, you felt unclean and uncomfortable in their presence, didn't you? So you say, "That man is a lustful person," or, "I'm a lustful person." Have you ever seen a person that was angry? How could you tell? You probably experienced their wrath. So you would say, "He's such an angry person," or, "I'm an angry person." No, you've got it all wrong. The enemy can never be defeated because you have become one with sin as if it were you, and you have made other people one with sin as if it were them. Many of your diseases are because you have become one with sin as if it were you. Well, you may have sin, but you are not sin. We say, "Well, that's just the way I am. I've been fearful all of my life. My parents were fearful and my kids are fearful, and you just have to love and accept me the way that I am." Well, I love you, but I don't like your fear. We have become one with sin as if it were us, and then we say that we have a personality disorder. This is where the psychiatrists are wrong. There is no such thing as a personality disorder. There is also a teaching that has penetrated the church all over the world today that says that you need to learn to stereotype people in order to get along with them better. Actually, it is so that you can adjust to their evil and enable them in their sin. They made people into the characters of animals. He's a bear, he's a lamb, he's a lion, etc. And that's why he acts like that. Well, I am not an animal. I am a daughter of God by faith. Do you know how many churches are filled with this teaching? Lots of them. This is the most dangerous type of Christianized horoscopes that I have ever seen in my life. Because when you stereotype people in ways that are not God's ways, you are binding them to a way of thinking that does not allow them to change. God is a God of change, because according to the Bible, our characters are being changed from glory to glory into the image of Jesus. We have become so one with sin that we call it human nature. For example, we say that it is just human nature to be fearful and anxious. Well, what you call human nature is not God's nature. A spiritual man has God's nature. A natural man does not have God's nature. And if you're a natural man, you're no different than an animal. You must be born again. You must have the Spirit of God to make you sons and daughters of God. Human nature is not evil. It's just that sin has joined with human nature and made it less than what God intended it to be. In Romans chapter 7, Paul talks about his own struggle with sin in his life. In verse 15, he explains that the good he wants to do, he just does not do, while the sinful things that he wants to get rid of, he just keeps doing. He says, "For I do not understand my own actions. I am baffled and bewildered. I do not practice or accomplish that which I wish, but I do the very thing which I loathe, which my moral instinct condemns." Have you ever been there? Have you ever felt self-condemned and discouraged because you want to stop sinning in a specific area, but the more you try, the more you fail? Well, firstly, you need a revelation of grace, which I'll be speaking about in part 4 of this session. In verse 17, Paul makes a statement which is very important for you to understand, because when you get it, it's going to make your whole walk with God a lot easier. "Now then, it is no longer I that do it, but the sin that dwells in me." The principle I am showing you here is called separation. You need to learn to separate yourself from the sin that dwells within you and the sin that dwells within your brother. In session 18, when I talk about forgiveness, I'm going to explain that when somebody wrongs you, you have got to separate that person from their sin. What we do is when somebody sins against us, we hate the person, because the person and their sin become one in our mind. You must remember who you are really at war against, and that is the devil and his kingdom. According to Ephesians 6 verse 12, we are not wrestling with flesh and blood, but against principalities and against the powers of darkness. Because we have made ourselves one with sin, we are at war with ourselves, and we are at war with our mother-in-law. We do not understand that the battle is not against flesh and blood, but against an invisible kingdom that has taught that person to think like it, and as a result, they have become one with it in their long-term memory, and their personality has become one with sin. When you forgive someone, you have got to separate the person from their sin, just as God separated you from your sin in his heart when he saved you. To forgive somebody, you don't have to condone their sin. You continue to hate the sin, but according to Luke chapter 6, you are commanded to love the person. You see, the person who wronged you is not sin. What he did is sin. If he's a born-again Christian, he's a child of God, whom God loves. He's a friend of Jesus, and the Holy Spirit lives within him. But he's got some sin tagging along in his life that needs to go. It's hindering his relationship and his walk with God. What I'm sharing with you here about separation is going to set you free, because it will be very hard for you to forgive your brother if you don't separate his sin from who he is as a person. When somebody victimizes you, if you are able to see that it is not them, but the sin that dwells within them, you will be able to exchange bitterness for compassion, and you will be able to love them, even though they are sinning against you. Now it is the same thing with yourself. It is not fun to confront the sin issues in your life that are behind your diseases, because those are the areas in the depths of your soul where you are the most sensitive and vulnerable. The spiritual root behind your diseases is usually the thing that is a sore point for you. So it is very uncomfortable when I put my finger on the things that make you feel unhappy, afraid, angry, unlovely, guilty, and so on the inside. But I want you to know it is not you. While you are doing a spiritual inventory of all the things that make you feel so awful, know that it isn't even you anyhow. God wants to release you from your guilt and from the accusing spirits that are accusing you to yourself. Just like the spirit of fear will tempt you via theta brainwave activity with fear and anxiety, accusing spirits will accuse you to yourself with thoughts in the first person. For example, I'll never forgive myself for what I did. I am such a bad person. I am a failure. I am inadequate. I am unworthy. I am unlovely. I am ugly. I am a useless nobody that will never amount to anything. Those thoughts were not originally yours. They were from accusing spirits, accusing you to yourself. They make you feel like you are sin. But God wants you to come out of the bondage of that mindset that you are evil and that you are no good. He wants you to see the creature of Hebrews 4 verse 13 and Ephesians chapter 6. That invisible kingdom is no good. You have a right to have a perfect hatred for sin in yourself and others, but you are free to love yourself this day. You can love your enemy because you understand that the sin within him is not him, and the sin that is in you is not you. But it is that invisible kingdom that needs to be defeated. Jesus demonstrated power over all unclean spirits and all the works of the devil, and he's given you the Holy Spirit and the power and the mandate to do the same thing. So stand up in your heart this day. Your Father has made you sons and daughters. You are God's child. Ephesians 1 verse 4 says that he chose you before the foundation of the world to be set apart for him. You are of great value and worth because you were worth the life of the King of Kings, according to John 3:16. Isaiah 61 verse 10 says that when God looks at you, he sees Jesus' robes of righteousness. Psalm 8 verse 5 says there is a crown of glory and honor on your head. In Jeremiah 1 verse 5, God said that he accepts and approves of you. In 1 John 2 verse 12, it says that the blood of Jesus has washed away your guilt and shame. There is now no condemnation for you in Christ, according to Romans 8 verse 1. You are a new creation in Christ, according to 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17. You are blessed with everything heaven has to offer. Galatians 3 verse 9 says you are God's favorite. He's called you to be a bride to his son. He's called you. You are special. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life of Heaven, according to Luke 10 verse 20. Isaiah 49 verse 16 says that your name is tattooed on the palm of his hands. Zechariah 2 verse 8 says you are the apple of his eye. Ephesians 1 verse 13 says you are stamped with the seal of the Holy Spirit. He's called you a victorious overcomer in 1 John 5 verse 4. He's called you a mighty woman and a mighty man of valor, a champion overcoming warrior who possesses dignity and honor. He's called you more than a conqueror in Romans 8 verse 35. You are a winner. You are valuable. You are precious. The bottom line is you are the King of Kings kid, and your daddy, who is the almighty, indescribable God, says that he loves you. So would you please stop listening to the devil's lies and get up and become the sons and daughters that you were created to be from the foundation of the world in Christ. It's time that you have the ability and the discernment to separate yourself from the sin within you so that you can defeat your enemy. If you can learn to do that, you'll never have a problem with guilt and condemnation again. You will be able to forgive yourself and love yourself while dealing with the sin in your life with the help of the Holy Spirit. The day that you get a revelation of what Paul said in Romans 7, where you learn to separate yourself and your heart from your sin, is the day that sanctification will begin in your life. That is where healing begins. That is when you are on your way to freedom. You are free to love yourself and others as you go through the process of sanctification, where you progressively get rid of the sin that is causing your spiritual, mental, and biological diseases.
You are the God that healeth. You are a God that reigns on high. You are a God of mercy, and your
in session 5, I mentioned that I believe that there is a revival of healing that is coming to this nation and across the world. But the revival is not coming in the way that you may think. This revival is going to be in the form of sanctification and purification of the hearts of God's people. The work of God in the earth today is one of sanctification. There is very little preaching today about sanctification, and that is why we don't see many people being healed and delivered. God hasn't done away with miraculous healing and deliverance. It's just that the Christian church must first submit to Him in holiness. But the purpose of sanctification is much more than just healing of our body. The ultimate purpose of sanctification is to mold us into the image of Jesus. Being molded into the image of Jesus means that the Holy Spirit works out of you your fleshly carnal traits and works into you the character and mind of Christ. In other words, you become more and more like Jesus. 2 Corinthians 3 verse 16 to 18 says, "But whenever a person turns in repentance to the Lord, the veil is stripped off and taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And all of us, with unveiled face, continue to behold in the Word of God, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, and are constantly being transfigured into His very own image in ever-increasing splendor from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit." Notice that the Scripture does not say, change yourself more and more so that you become like Jesus. That's impossible. As you get to know God through time spent in intimate fellowship with Him and in His Word, God will begin a work in your heart, a work of sanctification. He will begin to change you little by little. The Holy Spirit is the one who will mold you into the image of Christ. You cannot change yourself, so don't try and do that in your own strength. I am telling you up front at the onset, if you try to change yourself, it will not work. You will only end up feeling frustrated, disappointed, and defeated. Your job is just to get to know God and to love Him. God is the one who will bring about the change in you. Now I want to take you to 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17. But before I can do that, I need to talk about the NIV Bible. The NIV Bible is used by many Christians today, mainly because it is easy to read. However, the NIV Bible has 38,000 doctrinal changes, 30,000 changes in the Old Testament, and 8,000 changes in the New Testament. If you managed to get hold of a Catholic Bible from the 1800s, you would see that it is word for word what is written in the NIV Bible today. The NIV Bible is basically the Catholic Bible reprinted. The Dead Sea Scrolls have the entire book of Isaiah on them, and according to the Hebrew scholars, the King James Bible matches it exactly. The closest English translation to the book of Isaiah that can be found in the world today is the King James Version. In the NIV, the book of Isaiah differs from the King James by 50%. 50% of it has been changed. The NIV has changed words in the Bible, they've changed tenses, and they've taken out phrases. The NIV has even taken out entire scriptures from the Bible. For example, they have totally taken out Mark 11 verse 26, which is a crucial scripture, especially on the subject of healing, because it is one of the conditions to receiving, and I'm going to explain why in session 18. Mark 11 verse 26 was taken out of the NIV Bible because the NIV translator said that they questioned the authenticity of that scripture. If the scripture is there, it is footnoted saying that the scripture is not found in earlier manuscript evidence, and therefore it is invalid. What they are not telling you is that it is not in the Symmaticus and Vernaticus, which came to us in the Roman Catholic Church in the 4th century. What they are also not telling you is that Symmaticus and Vernaticus only accounts for 1% of all manuscript evidence going back to the 4th century. However, this scripture is in 99% of all manuscript evidence in the world, which is 6,000 pieces of papyrus, etc., going back to the 1st century. So the NIV is a minority text. What is amazing in the NIV is that they didn't even change the numbering system despite taking out that scripture. Not only is verse 26 missing, but they've dropped the number and didn't even change the numbering system of the rest of the chapter. So you go from verse 25 to verse 27. And just to let you know how ridiculous this is, the scripture that they took out in Mark 11 verse 26 is found in Matthew 6 verse 14. Why is it valid in Matthew 6 verse 14 and not valid in Mark 11 verse 26? Everywhere you turn in the NIV Bible, there is always some scripture that is footnoted as suspect, and it always has to do with the identification of hell, the deity of Christ, and the ability of the believer to represent God the Father in the name of Jesus. They have created a social gospel that no longer holds the believer responsible for sin. More and more, they are removing the responsibility of believers to operate in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and more, they are removing that healing is for today. For example, Isaiah 61 verse 1 was a prophecy about Jesus, where it says that he came to heal the brokenhearted and to set the spiritual and physical captives free. In Luke 4 verse 18, Jesus is in the temple, and he quotes Isaiah 61 verse 1 to say that he's come to fulfill that scripture. In the NIV Bible, you will see that they have removed that phrase, "He came to heal the broken heart," from Luke 4 verse 18. So if you are trying to minister to somebody who has, for example, allergies that is caused by the broken heart, and you want to prove to them in scripture that God heals the broken heart today, and you have an NIV Bible, have fun, because you won't find it there. The phrase that Jesus came to heal the broken heart has been dropped because they removed it to a historical time 2,000 years ago when healing passed away with the apostles. Do you think the Catholic priests want you healing the sick? No, the priests want to be the only ones that are qualified to do that. Some of the scriptures that have been changed in the NIV Bible mirror the Freemasonry book. We see from Revelations 19 verse 13 that Jesus is the Word of God. In 1 John 1 verse 14 it says that the Word became flesh. In the NIV Bible it says that the Word took on the appearance of flesh, and that is what it says in the Freemasonry book. Jesus did not take on the appearance of flesh, he literally became a human being. In Freemasonry it says that Jesus, they don't actually use the name of Jesus, they say Christos, took on the appearance of flesh. The Bible says that any spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ came in the flesh is the spirit of the Antichrist. So those that have an NIV Bible need to seriously think about this. Why would you want to read a Bible where the Word of God has been so severely compromised? Having said all that about the NIV, let's go to 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. I just quoted the scripture to you from the King James Bible, which is the most accurate translation that there is today, as it is the closest that there is to the original Hebrew manuscript evidence. If you have an NIV Bible, you'll see that the tenses in this scripture have been changed, and that is a grave error which has changed the meaning of this verse entirely. The NIV Bible says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, and the new has come. The NIV says that the old past tense has gone. If the old has gone, why does the Christian church still have so much of the old sinful nature in it? Why are Christians still so full of bitterness, unforgiveness, hatred, jealousy, envy, strife, gossip, adultery, low self-esteem, divorce, lust, etc.? That is not the new nature of God. That is the old sinful nature of the flesh. Why is the old sinful nature of the flesh still in you if you are a fully formed new creation? What many modern churches are teaching is that when Christ died for you, it was finished. The old has, past tense, passed away, and you are a new creation. However, the Christian church is so confused and disillusioned because when you look at the church in practical reality, they are caught in a world where they are not new. Either the Word of God is true or it is not. The Word of God is true, providing it has been preserved. The King James says that old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. That word are in the Greek, as found in the historical manuscript, is present tense progressive. That is referring to the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit in the believer after being born again, as he progressively works out of you your old sinful nature and works into you the new nature and character of Christ. If you are a new creature and all things have passed away, as it says in the NIV, then you don't need sanctification because you are already perfect. There is nothing sinful left in you. In that case, what are we still preaching and discipling for? When we become born again, Jesus not only wants to be our Savior, he wants to be our Lord. Even as born-again believers, there are areas in our life where Jesus is not Lord because we are still serving our old sinful nature. Therefore, we still need to disciple believers because there are old things that have not passed away in their lives, but they should be progressively passing away. If the old has passed away already, then what is the meaning of 2 Corinthians 3 verse 18 that I quoted to you earlier, which says, from glory to glory, we are being changed into his image. We are being changed. That is present tense progressive. We are progressively becoming a new creation in Christ as an ongoing process of sanctification in our lives every single day. Paul said in Philippians 2 verse 12 to 13, work out, cultivate, carry out to the goal, and fully complete your own salvation with reverence and awe and trembling. Being a Christian is not about saying the sinner's prayer and then that's it. That is only the beginning of a journey of sanctification of the heart. Every day you need to continue in the process of working out your own salvation with fear and trembling. You need to apply God's love, mercy and grace, plug into the Word, spend time in His presence, and cooperate with the Holy Spirit in purging your heart from sin. This is what sanctification is all about. And how long your process of sanctification takes depends on you to a large degree. Sanctification is about change. From glory to glory, we are being changed into His image. But the only place you can be changed is in God's presence. You need to abide in the vine. You need to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. If you don't spend time with God, and if you don't make the effort to renew your mind with the Word, your process of sanctification is going to be a slow process, or it may not even happen at all. So you are a born-again Christian, and you may have been a born-again Christian for 10 or 20 or 50 years, but because you are seldom in God's presence and seldom in the Word, you are an unchanged, unsanctified, defeated, miserable, sick Christian who is no different than an unbeliever. When you are seldom in God's presence, you very easily and very quickly backslide into the ways of the world, and there are worse consequences than sickness to an unsanctified life. Jesus said in Revelation 3 verse 5, "He who conquers and is victorious," the King James says, "He who overcomes shall be clad in white garments, and I will not erase or blot out his name from the book of life. I will acknowledge him as mine, and I will confess him openly before my Father and before his angels." In Revelation 3 verse 5, there is a clear indication to a believer who refuses to be an overcomer and who refuses to change and to be sanctified and to establish the kingdom of God in his life, that if he hardens his heart to the things of God, there is a very distinct possibility that Jesus himself will blot their name out of the book of life and will refuse to confess his name before the Father. In Galatians 5 verse 19 to 21, Paul listed the works of the flesh: idolatry, witchcraft, strife, jealousy, anger, drunkenness, adultery, etc. Then in verse 21 he said, "Those who do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Remember, I explained in session 10 that the word "do" in this scripture means to habitually practice as a way of life, as opposed to a single act. Believers that habitually harden their hearts to sin and serve and practice it without repentance and conviction will not inherit the kingdom of God. As I teach you, I would like to remind you that I didn't write the Bible, so don't get cross with me when I quote it. Do you know what we are doing? We are preaching a New Age, life enhancement, social gospel. We are afraid that we are going to lose the people that tithe, so we want to please man by preaching a feel-good sermon. We are so concerned about being speaker-friendly that we have forgotten about righteousness. While we are not doing anybody a favor, because God's people are living with one foot in the church and the other foot in the world, and they do not apprehend the serious ground that they are walking on. Jesus went on to say in Revelation 3 verse 15 to 16, "You are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew you out of my mouth." Jesus also said in Matthew 7 verse 21 to 23, "Not everybody who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and drive out demons and perform many miracles?' And I will say to them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" The people in this scripture never really got to know God because they were seldom in his presence. As a result, they remained unchanged in their hearts and continued in their evil doing. There are people that will heal the sick, cast out devils, do miracles and creative cures, and preach the gospel as believers, and they will still go to hell. The Bible says that at the judgment seat of Christ, the Lord himself will separate the weeds from the wheat. There will be those who will come before the Lord personally, and they will say, "Hello, Lord." You see, these people have been taught eternal security, and they come before the Lord expecting to hear, "Well done, my faithful servant." However, instead, they hear the Lord Jesus say to them, "Who are you?" And the person says, "What do you mean, who am I?" And Jesus says, "Who are you? I don't know you. Why are you here?" And the person says, "What do you mean, why am I here? What do you mean that you don't know me? I preached the gospel, I healed the sick, I cast out devils, and even did cures in your name. You still don't know me? And Jesus says, Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. And the person is cast alive into outer darkness. That little insight into the future has been a sobering challenge and wake-up call to me as a human. As a church, we need to wake up out of our passive, mediocre, lukewarm walk with God. We need to cultivate a hunger for His Word. We need to make an effort to get to know the Father more. We need to fall in love with Him again. We need to stir up within our hearts a passion for His name. We need to be radical and outrageous in obedience. We need to love Him and serve Him, not because of anything that we are going to get out of Him, but simply because He is worthy. This is the teaching that has been historically a part of Christianity, but in modern times, we've lost it. We all know Revelation 3 verse 20, where Jesus says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him, and he will eat with me. We often quote that scripture when giving the salvation message, which is what I did in session 8, and that is fine. But if you look at that scripture in context, you will realize that Jesus was not talking to the unsaved. He was speaking to the New Testament church. Revelations 3 verse 19 to 20 in context says, Those whom I dearly and tenderly love, I tell their faults and convict and convince and reprove and chasten. I discipline and instruct them. So be enthusiastic and earnest and burning with zeal and repent, changing your mind and attitude. And then we come to verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears and listens to and heeds my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and will eat with him, and he will eat with me. In the scripture, the Lord was not in the hearts of the people in the New Testament church as they thought he was. He was on the outside. This is often a tragic picture of the church today. The Lord is saying to you, I'm here, knocking at the door of your heart. Would you allow me to come in with the Holy Spirit to cleanse and sanctify you? Would you allow me to remove the things in your life which is part of the old sinful nature and work into you my nature so that you can be transformed into my image? Could I heal and deliver you? Could I establish my kingdom in your heart, which is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit? Could I be Savior to you? Could I be Lord of all to you? Would you enter into that degree of covenant with me? Could I be a husband to you? Would you fellowship with me? Would you enter into that depth of relationship and intimacy with me? I've explained previously that the only way to get to know somebody is to build a friendship with them is to spend time with them. I must emphasize that you need to spend time with God. Getting to know God by spending time with Him involves finding a quiet place where it is just you and God, where you can sit at His feet and just enjoy fellowship with Him. The more time you spend with God, and the more time you spend in fellowship with Him and in His Word, the more you will get to really know Him. The more you get to know God, the more you will come to genuinely love Him. And out of your love for Him, naturally flows a life of obedience. Only when you spend time in God's presence will you be changed. In His presence is where your heart is sanctified, and little by little, you are molded into the image of Christ.
And you are the God that healeth. You are a God that reigns on high. You are a God of mercy. And your grace, reigns down.
In previous sessions, I repeatedly emphasized the importance of obedience and being a doer of the word. Now I need to bring that into balance by briefly speaking about grace. I am not going to go into a detailed teaching about grace, because it is not the main focus of this teaching. But it would be very unfair if I did not at least mention it, because change in our life, including renewing our mind, only comes by God's grace. All teaching in this DVD series about changing your thinking in various areas must be built on a clear knowledge of grace. We all understand God's grace as His unmerited favor, but there is far more to it than that. There is a much greater revelation. God's grace is His power and ability that He gives us to change and to do what He's called us to do, which we would not otherwise be able to do in our own strength. That is grace. This is the key to the whole issue about grace. We cannot change ourselves in our own strength and with our own effort and ability. Only God can change us. The bottom line is that if God doesn't do it, it won't get done. You need to understand that you cannot change yourself. Sometimes when people hear a message that they recognize as truth, they are so eager to apply it that they move into works of the flesh by trying to bring about the change in their own strength. One of the worst mistakes that you can make after hearing this teaching about changing your thinking in certain areas is to make the decision that you are now going to go on a mission to change yourself and your thinking by your own human effort and ability. You may be able to keep this up for a day or two, but sooner or later you will fall and end up disappointed, discouraged, disillusioned, and frustrated. I've certainly been round that mountain a few times in my life, trying and trying to change myself, but just ending up frustrated. What I was doing was operating under the law, which the Bible says will always lead to frustration and eventually to disappointment and destruction. The law is the opposite to grace. In Galatians 3 verse 10 we read, "And all who depend on the law, who are seeking to be justified by obedience to the law of rituals, are under a curse and doomed to disappointment and destruction. For it is written in the scriptures, cursed and devoted to destruction is everyone who does not continue to abide, live and remain by all the precepts and commandments written in the book of the law and to practice them." When we try to obey God and change ourselves into what the Bible says we should be with our own effort, we unconsciously put ourselves under the curse of the law. We can make a law out of every word of the Bible if we do not know how to respond to it properly. Instead of seeing this teaching as something we need to accomplish, we need to see it as a promise of what God will fulfill in us as we draw close to Him and trust Him to do it. When we put ourselves under the law by trying to change ourselves by our own effort, we set ourselves up for misery. This is because the law has the potential to do one of two things. It can make us holy if we follow it perfectly, but no human being can do that. So the second thing that the law can do is to actually increase sin, which leads to destruction. Chapter 2 and 3 in the book of Romans teach us that God gave the Old Testament law so that man would try to keep it and realize that he could not. This then shows him his desperate need for a savior. Trying to obey God through our own striving and human effort is in vain. We end up frustrated and disappointed because every other day we keep failing and giving up. One of the meanings of the word frustrate is to prevent from obtaining a goal or fulfilling a desire. Just as Paul explained in Galatians 3 verse 10, we end up frustrated and eventually being destroyed by trying to live by the law, which is totally impossible for us to keep. We are trying to obtain a goal and fulfill a desire to change ourselves that is beyond our ability. The harder we try, the more miserably we fail. When we put all our energy and effort into something that is doomed to failure, the only possible outcome is frustration. And then all we know to do is to try harder, which only produces more frustration. This vicious cycle can only be broken by a revelation of God's grace. In her book, If Not for the Grace of God, Joyce Meyer shared the following testimony from her own life. She said, "I became so sick and tired of being upset and frustrated that I eventually cried out, 'Father, I can't do this anymore. I have done everything I know to do and nothing is working. If anything is going to change, you are going to have to do it.'" When she said that, she heard the Holy Spirit say, "Great, now I can go to work. That is exactly what I've been waiting for you to stop trying to change yourself and to start trusting me to do it." Throughout the teaching in this DVD series, there will be areas of wrong thinking and negative mindsets which will be brought to your attention that are causing your diseases and problems with your health. The Holy Spirit will convict you of your need to change in these areas. But you must not respond to that by trying to change yourself and become everything that the Word says you are supposed to be in your own strength and ability. Only the power of the Holy Spirit and God's grace can accomplish the change in you that is needed. This is such a powerful revelation. You and I cannot change ourselves, but we can spend time seeking the one who can change us. That's the required action on your part, just to draw close to God, to love Him, and to trust Him to do the sanctifying work in your heart. Joyce Meyer teaches that rather than trying to work the Word, you must let the Word work in you. You cannot use the power of your will to change yourself, but you can use your willpower to spend time with God and in His Word. When you do this, you put yourself in a position for Him to change you. The right way to respond to the teaching of the Word is to say, "Yes, Lord, I agree with you. Your Word is truth and my life is not matching up to it. Your Word has become a mirror to me and I can see that I am wrong in this aspect and I ask for your forgiveness. I can see that I need to change my thinking in this area, but I am powerless to do it without you, Lord. Your Word says that I can do nothing apart from you. Father, I acknowledge that I am totally dependent on you, and I can only be what you empower me to be. I am trusting you to give me the grace, power, and ability to do what you have called me to do. As I draw close to you and get to know you through time spent with you and studying your Word, I'm trusting that you will change me by your grace. Show me what to do and give me the power to do it." You see, without God's grace being applied to our lives, we will never be able to have any kind of long-lasting change in our thought life or any area for that matter. Although we often quote Philippians 4 verse 13, which says, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," that is only true by God's grace. Remember, Jesus said in John 15 verse 5, "Apart from me, cut off from vital union with me, you can do nothing." God's grace frees us from all attempts to achieve anything or to try to change ourselves in our own strength and human effort. When you let go and exchange trying for trusting, you'll see how God's dynamic power will transform your life as you simply yield yourself to receive His amazing grace. Now, God's grace does not cover sin so that it doesn't matter. Grace does not mean you can sin as you like and you don't have to worry about the consequences. That is a terrible misunderstanding about grace. Grace is what empowers you not to sin and to live a godly life, which you cannot do in your own strength. God's grace also does not mean that you should never make any effort to achieve or accomplish anything in life. There is a proper effort that we as believers have to put out there, but this is an effort that must be made through the power and by the grace of God at work within us. In other words, don't attempt to do anything without first asking for God's help. You must lean on Him the whole way through this process of renewing your mind and changing your thinking. You need to maintain an attitude that says, "Apart from Him, I can do nothing."
You are the God.